6G. What is it? Why do we need it? What are the security ramifications? And whose evolution will this support? What are the health and... With China recently announcing research and development into 6G, the race is on. With 5G standard just recently locked down and the first 5G networks rolling out at the end of this year, and that would be 2018, we don't know what effect 5G will have on society. The initial 6G study groups will be focused on exploring technologies that aren't yet possible, but that will evolve what the industry is doing with 5G. Take those terahertz radio frequencies. To enable very high data rates and capacities, 5G pushes cellular radios up into the multi-gigahertz frequencies, also called millimeter waves. So it is too surprising that 6G will look at going even. The group will also look at making policy recommendations for a high-speed AI-enabled world. Besides technology advances, there will be a wave of societal changes due to massive digitalization of services. This will call for novel incentive and business models in addition to telecom regulation and legislation. The 6G technology market is expected to facilitate large improvements in the areas of imaging, presence technology, or should we say situational awareness, and location awareness, or geotagging, geolocation mapping. Working in conjunction with AI, the computational infrastructure of 6G will be able to autonomously determine the best location for computing to occur. This includes decisions about data storage, processing, and sharing. So it will decide what we can share, who we can share it with, and if we can share? That's a question. Now, 6G is expected to support 1 terabit per second in data transfers and bandwidth. This level of capacity and latency will be unprecedented and will extend the performance of 5G applications along with expanding the scope of capabilities and support of increasingly new and innovative applications across realms of wireless cognition, sensing, and imaging. 6G's higher frequencies will enable much faster sampling rates in addition to providing significantly better throughput. Bigger pipe, more data. The combination of sub-millimeter waves and the use of frequency selectivity to determine relative electromagnetic absorption rates is expected to lead to potentially significant advances in wireless sensing solutions. They don't go on to explain what wireless sensing solutions are, so we can pretty much leave that up to our imagination. Mobile edge computing will be built into all 6G networks. Now, what is MEC, or mobile or edge computing? I explain this in detail in my report about Jade Helm, that the Jade is an AI software program. This is kind of like how Facebook knows how to, you know, Facebook recommends people you should friend based on people you might know, based on people who have maybe similar interests, recommending groups, that type of thing. That's one aspect of edge computing. Edge and core computing will become much more seamlessly integrated as part of a combined communications computation infrastructure framework by the time 6G networks are deployed. This will provide many potential advantages as 6G technology becomes operational, including improved access to artificial intelligence capabilities. Now, some may argue that artificial intelligence, AI, or as I like to refer to it as MI or machine intelligence, is already kind of running amok behind the scenes. This will just give it greater opportunity to thrive and survive in a network that is not only an Internet of Things where everything is connected, but it will be a network that is an Internet of Everything. In all the articles I've read, They're looking at a target date of 2030 for the rollout of 6G. Based on history, I would say that this rollout will probably hit sooner than 2030. Now, don't forget, even with 5G, they rolled it out. Discussions regarding the safety of biological entities exposed to 5G for prolonged periods has been completely set aside, swept off the table. The only thing they care about is, does it work? Will it work? And it's going to be the same type of mindset that goes forward, throws caution to the wind, and rolls out this 6G technology. Now, it goes on to say that 6G will have big implications for many government, industry, and public safety and critical asset protection, such as threat detection. Well, are they referring to pre-crime? Health monitoring. Are they referring to health triaging or automated health management? In other words, if, say, you're older and your medical expenses, your medical maintenance outweighs your societal contribution, will you be deemed discardable? Feature and facial recognition, police state, through and through. Decision-making in areas like law enforcement and social credit systems. Social credit systems? Looks like we're going the way of China. Air quality measurements, gas and toxicity sensing. Now to the question of, do we even need 5G? Here's what the experts say. More than ever before, the sixth generation of cellular wireless communications will integrate a set of previously disparate technologies, including deep learning and big data analytics. The introduction of 5G paves the way for much of this convergence. And if any of you are interested in what that convergence may look like, please check out my video, The Day After Singularity. They say the need to deploy edge computing to ensure overall throughput and low latency for ultra-reliable, low-latency communication solutions is an important driver for 6G, as is the need to support machine-to-machine communication in the Internet of Things. Machines talking to machines, being governed by artificial intelligence, controlling all of our devices. Can't see anything terribly wrong happening there. Furthermore, a strong relationship has been identified between future 6G solutions and high-performance computing. Now, if any of you want to know more about high-performance computing, please see my report on Obama's executive order on HPC. Fog computing is a term we should all keep on our radar. As best as I can ascertain and define it, it appears to be a swarm-based technology where, you know, AIs have a specific mission function, a target and identification, swarm together to achieve their goals. This article goes on to say that while sometimes referred to as edge technology, fog is more comprehensive. It bridges between device, edge, and cloud in a superset of functionality that communicates over multiple networks in a north-south, east-west approach between systems. So what this is primarily saying is that it will create a cross-platform ability and capability among networks, computing and software platforms, and everything, basically everything that's on the IoT. Now, all of these articles that I've read and some of them that I've shared with you all extol the virtues of 5G and the up-and-coming 6G from a security and privacy standpoint. But are these articles telling you that 5G and 6G have significant security problems? No, they are not. 5G and 6G wireless network technologies promise faster speeds and greater reliability, but they have security problems that must be addressed before they launch. Now, like I said before, with you know, this steamroller rollout of 5G. They didn't care if it was safe. They didn't care if your data was secure. They didn't care if your privacy is protected. All they cared about was, does it work? And why will these new 5G and 6G networks be less secure? That's because security measures aren't being adopted in new 5G standards, and there's a newly discovered potential for a man-in-the-middle attack in the terahertz-based 6G networks. In the race to the top in these new technology wars, Trump recently said, "I want 5G and even 6G technology in the United States as soon as possible. It is far more powerful, faster, and smarter than the current standard. American companies must step up their efforts or get left behind. There is no reason we should be lagging behind." In the race to be number one, it seems that governments and technology companies, big tech companies, are throwing caution to the wind. These technologies have not been adequately researched for not only their societal, cultural effects on humanity, but from a safety aspect as well. We know that people who live near these 5G towers in close proximity and are constantly bombarded with these millimeter waves are experiencing health problems. We know that the exposure to millimeter waves, at least in plants and lower life forms, destroys the mitochondria of the cell, which is the powerhouse for cell reproduction and cell repair. Now, once you destroy that, what do you have left? This article asks the question, what will 6G be like? Well, one answer, a high-level answer, is that 6G will explore and include relevant technologies that will be left out from 5G due to being too late, experimental in status, or simply outside the defined scope for 5G. Future applications and technologies will be integrated when they achieve maturity. What does that mean? There is a plethora of possibilities to that definitive statement. For 6G, one proposal is to integrate terrestrial, wireless, and satellite systems for ubiquitous, always-on broadband global network coverage. There will be no escaping the Borg. Yet other trends predicted for 6G include ultra-dense cell networks. I mean, 5G requires antennas, receivers, transmitters, what, every 600 feet for virtual penetration? Goes on to say reconfigurable hardware, millimeter waves for user access, enhanced optical wireless interfaces, network VLC, intelligent networking and technologies to enable full immersive experience for users. Now, what are they saying here? Will this technology actually have the ability, since it's an always-on global network, to bring in virtual reality or altered reality scenarios into your home or into your sphere without you actually calling or requesting these simulations to experience? Exposure to terahertz electromagnetic radiation reveals structural transitions in macromolecules. Exposure induces these structural changes by changing the bonding properties of biological macromolecules. Even limited exposure versus bombardment of terahertz radiation in a 6G world changes the way enzymes and enzymatic systems work in cells. There's already hundreds of documented studies on the deleterious effects of 5G radiation in the 300 to 900 gigahertz range on biological organisms, plants, insects, animals, and humans. These studies show prolonged persistent exposure breaks down the mitochondria of cells, preventing healthy regeneration of cells. 6G also affects or breaks down the neurological communication process in neurons and also creates permeability of cell membranes to allow in or transport unwanted or unnatural substances in the living cells which are normally blocked. Both at the cellular and subcellular level, exposure to terahertz frequencies change cellular enzymatic systems, activity, and membrane properties. All of these effects will have a compromising effect on the brain, the heart, organs, neurological, and circulatory functions in the body. All in all, great things are expected of terahertz waves, the radiation that fills the slot in the electromagnetic spectrum between microwaves and infrared. Terahertz waves pass through non-conducting materials such as clothes, paper, wood, and brick, and so cameras sensitive to them can peer inside envelopes into your homes and to frisk people at a distance. At first glance, it's easy to dismiss any notion that they can be damaging. Terahertz photons are not energetic enough to break chemical bonds or ionize atoms or molecules, but there could be another mechanism at work. The evidence that terahertz radiation damages biological systems is mixed. Some studies reported significant genetic damage, while others, although similar, showed none. Studies out there which have modeled terahertz fields show how these electromagnetic frequencies interact with double-stranded DNA, and what they found is remarkable. They say that although the forces generated are tiny, resonant effects allow terahertz waves to unzip double-stranded DNA, creating bubbles in the double strand that could significantly interfere with processes such as gene expression and DNA replication. It also explains why evidence has been so hard to garner. Ordinarily, resonant effects are not powerful enough to do this kind of damage, but nonlinear resonances can. These nonlinear resonances and instabilities are much less likely to form, which explains why the character of terahertz genotoxicity effects are probabilistic rather than deterministic. We're entering into an uncharted technological landscape. Will this new technology, 5G, 6G, make our lives better? Or are we creating a dystopian nightmare for the future? Thank you for watching, and please share this video.